make sure that that program doesn't contain controversial subjects, and you're not impolite to people.
Oh, definitely not, Dad. You know me. I'm never, ever controversial or impolite.
Yeah. Okay.
Welcome to Conversations with your lovable, never pisses anyone off, never been banned from Facebook or YouTube, never been sabotaged or censored for politely expressing a difference of opinion, ex-Muslim host Aina, keeping it non-controversial.
Welcome to the third panel episode of Polite Conversations on the Burkini Hijab Niqab debate. Today, I have an excellent panel for you, one that's been quite tricky to assemble, actually. We've got Sarah Haider.
Hello.
Writer, activist, and co-founder of Ex-Muslims of North America. And we have Hoda Katebi.
Yes.
Muslim Iranian activist and blogger at Juju Azad. She's also the author of the book Tehran Street Style. And we also have Hala Arafa, who is a former newscaster and news editor at the Voice of America Arabic branch.
Hello. How are you guys?
Well, hopefully we're all well. I'm so glad you all could make it.
Well.
I have tried to get so many people on to discuss this topic, and I can tell you how many people turned me down.
Oh.
Yeah. It seems to be like not everyone wants to have this discussion. I wonder why. But okay, so Sarah, you wrote a really good piece on this. It was really balanced and fair. And of course, on Twitter, you were attacked for that.
Yes.
So what were some of the things that you were talking about in your piece?
Well, generally speaking, I mean, I understand why people feel the need to fight back against Islamism and, you know, the hijab and the, you know, burkini and various, you know, very obviously religious garb. I can understand why people feel that, you know, if we eliminate this, it will ease tensions. It will, you know, somehow send a message, the right kind of message that we want you to assimilate. I just don't think that it's very intelligent. I don't think it's very practical. I don't think it does what you want it to do, which is to say that I don't think it curbs extremism in any real sense. And I don't think it helps the most vulnerable Muslim women.
Right. And actually, it turns out it boosted burkini sales.
So, right.
So, yeah, I think I agree with you quite a bit on that. I've been pretty open about how critical I am about religious modesty garb, but I don't necessarily agree with banning it because I don't think it's effective. I think you have to coax people out of these types of beliefs and not force them out of these types of beliefs. And Hoda, you are the only person on our panel that has a current experience, I guess, everyday experience wearing the hijab, right? Do you wear a burkini?
No, I haven't been. I've always lived in a landlocked state in the United States, so no chance to wear a burkini. I'm in the fashion industry and don't find them particularly fashion forward, so I just haven't worn them, but that's...
Well, what do you go swimming at all in the pool or?
I've gone swimming when I was in Iran. I went swimming, and there you don't need a burkini because they just section off a whole part of the Caspian Sea for you. and women would wear whatever they wanted and just.
Well, how do they do that effectively?
It's not the most effective thing. It's more lax than people would imagine. It's basically like the material that tents are made out of, but it's kind of built into the water and they just kind of like a little wall basically, on both sides. And it's just an expansive area.
Everything is segregated there. So I think it would be difficult.
Well, not everything. some things are segregated. Yeah, but definitely not everything.
Do you feel that, like, the hijab and these modesty coverings are a form of segregation, or no?
I don't think that necessarily a hijab is a form of segregation, especially I think we should also talk about the difference with a Muslim woman or a woman wearing the hijab in Iran, where it is mandatory, or in Saudi Arabia.
than a woman choosing to wear a hijab freely in France or the United States, for example. Like, I think those have very different significance to
absolutely
them.
But I mean, firstly, we can't really say who's choosing and who's not, because it's just, it's very hard to gauge that, right? Like, there's subtle pressures as well from family. Like, I have family members that wear hijab, and I have a relative that puts her 9-year-old in a hijab who is obviously not old enough to consent to it.
So, yeah, but I mean, I do think that there is pressure to wear a hijab, but I think there's also pressure not to wear a hijab. Like, as a Muslim woman who chooses to wear the hijab in the United States, if at anything at all I've seen around me are people constantly saying, take it off, you know, like, oh, I'm sure your hair is pretty, take off your hijab. You know, people right. have actually pulled it off my head. So I think that they're equal, if not more, pressure to take off the hijab.
I don't know if it would be equal at all, but
yeah, I wouldn't say equal. Come on, Hoda.
I mean, like,
in other countries, they will throw acid on the face of anybody who's not wearing it, including Christians. This is, I'm talking about Egypt.
Right.
And I've seen Christian women, actually, my mom died last April, so I had to do some stuff in the government and certain papers, and I went in and I saw this woman with a cross on her forearm. But she's wearing a hijab. I told her, what are you doing? She said, if I go home, if I walk on my street not wearing the hijab, I'd be attacked. So I'm wearing it.
I think that's obviously very, very awful. But saying that for me and my experience, and also like other millions of Muslims around the world, to kind of take that away, that we feel we don't see constant pressure to take off the hijab. Like, I was physically assaulted multiple times. Like, I was beaten up for wearing the hijab. But I've never had that threat in
Where
Oklahoma.
Where is that?
In the United States.
You were beaten up?
Yes.
For wearing a hijab? Where?
Yes.
How?
In Oklahoma, in the United States.
Like, just walking down the street?
From a kid in my school. I was in school, and a kid actually, after he continuously called me a terrorist, and he's like, you should take it off, and I kept saying no, and he beat me up, and a teacher actually who was standing there turned around so she didn't have to see it. So again, like, I'm not at all saying that there's no pressure from Muslims for other people to wear other Muslim women to wear the hijab. Like, of course, I think that's bad. But for me, at least, there's been tremendous, extreme more pressure coming from the outside for me to take it off. So much more. And for other, like, millions of other Muslims. I've talked to so many other Muslim women who also have faced similar experiences.
Yeah.
So it definitely is, like, equal, if not more.
Well, tell me, why did you choose to wear it? This is Hala. I just want to know, why did you choose to wear it?
Well, I think it's definitely, for me, it's a fluid part of my identity. So it's something that changes. So I can't say I've always worn it for the exact same reasons, just the same reason that, I work in fashion. The way that I dress has changed also for, you know, throughout the course of my life. But also, I think it's important not to let one person's choice and relationship to the hijab become a standard for all women, because there's billions of women.
No, I get that. But when you say that there's, if not more pressure to take off the hijab, I think that's hugely inaccurate. I mean, I totally get that there is pressure to take it off sometimes. And I can see why that would be a deterrent when someone is constantly telling you to do something that's something that you really wouldn't want to do. But I don't think it's in any way comparable to, like, if you think of the majority of hijab wearing women, where do they reside? They reside in the Muslim world. And what happens there? They don't get a choice. So, I mean,
that's what I'm saying. Like regulatory, like forced hijab, as in like a state sanctioned thing. Like, I'm against that 100%. But to say that I haven't, or many other Muslim women who choose to wear the hijab in the United States, haven't received more pressure to take off the hijab than put it on, I think is like denying my experiences.
But even in the West, though, we can't even begin to gauge how many women are pressured into it. So we can't.
Yeah, I know. But we also can't say that it's just completely inaccurate that I haven't received, or other Muslim women
I'm not negating your experience at all. I'm saying I know absolutely that you must have faced discrimination or whatever because of it. And I am completely against that as well. You know, I stand up against that kind of stuff all the time. But I just don't think that it's fair to say that it is equal, if not more, pressure to remove the hijab, because I don't see anyone forcing you to take it off. If it's some crazy dude on the street, maybe, but that's a one-off experience. It's not like your regular...
But it's not, though. Like, I would love to agree with you, but, like, it's not... Like, again, I'm talking from my personal experience, but there's also countless statistics and surveys that prove that this is a very large problem. Like,
that people are ripping off hijabs?
No, yeah, I beg to differ.
I work very closely with organizations that document this information. I'm not just like making it up, you know, like it's like, I think
why
it's
just kind FBI. Of
like a yes, no okay, let's kind just, of game, but like you can't deny my experiences or just like the countless women that I've talked to.
Nobody's denying your experience. Nobody's denying your experience, but
we're not denying it, but we're not generalizing.
I'm just saying that
FBI, the FBI report, the annual report of the FBI about hate crimes motivated either by race or religion, they still put the Jews on top of the list, 57%, as opposed to the Muslims, 16%.
Okay, but how is that saying that,
and then,
but that doesn't negate the fact that Muslims still face discrimination? It doesn't make, I never once said that Muslims
153
have more
incidents
in the world.
Uh-huh. 153 incidents over a period of a year in 50 states does not mean it's widespread. Yes, there are some Americans who might be scared with good reason.
There's never good reason to like rip someone's
also,
hijab off.
I think I never reported the fact that my hijab was torn off or the fact that I was beaten up to the FBI.
You
and
should.
I think a lot of Muslims don't.
But you were beaten up in the schoolyard, right? I mean, this
is a
children's fight, though. This is different from adult.
But is it a children's fight? But like when you see things on the news, like it shows that we're part of a culture. This is all part of like a culture of Islamophobia that's cultivated in the United States.
It's not just
a schoolyard, you like talk to my crush or something. It's not that, like, you clearly, when they call you a terrorist, you know, when they call you like, oh, take that thing off your head, you know, like all these sort of things, like don't blow me up, where's the bomb, like it's more than just like a schoolyard thing.
It's obviously
related to what they hear on their television screen.
As ex-Muslims, we still get that, right?
I'm not an ex-Muslim. I'm a very, very pious practicing Muslim.
No, but I'm saying even as ex-Muslims like Sarah and I are, we still get anti-Muslim bigotry directed towards us. I get told that I should be sterilized because I can't be trusted to breed and stuff like that. So I get it. I've personally experienced it. I'm just trying to get some sense of proportion here.
Well, I think, mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's important here to sort of clarify what we're talking about, because I think we're talking over each other. But for one, I don't think anyone is saying that it's impossible that women who wear the hijab get, harassed or there are some forces that pull them in the direction of taking off the hijab. I don't think that that's really being denied here by anybody. Mm-hmm. And I agree that it happens. And I've even, you know, seen it happen. But I think it's important to make a distinction between what's happening in the aggregate and perhaps an individual experience that is very much different from the aggregate. So I think it's fair to say that there are stronger pulls with perhaps the average Muslim woman. Now, I don't have data here, but I'm just speaking from what I think is reasonable analysis of what we do have, to say that the average Muslim woman might experience a stronger pull to be more modest, to put on the hijab than she does to take it off. Not to say that she doesn't have any pulls to take it off to, just that there's a greater pull in one direction, and it's coming from family, friends, community, and I think that's the most important thing, because those are the people you don't want to leave. Those are the people you don't want to be isolated from.
Exactly.
And so they have, you know, just a overwhelmingly strong presence when it comes to, you know, a coercive action one way or another.
Yeah, so actually, I do a lot of research in Iran, because I'm Iranian. All my research is focused in Iran. I think it's a really interesting country. In Iran, among the youth, it's actually the opposite. So despite the fact that there's a law, like a mandatory law for all women to be wearing the hijab, it's, you're pulled by your friends to take it off, or kind of like have this sort of like pulling it, you know, just having your ponytail and just setting it on your ponytail, or like having it around your shoulders until the cops come up. So there's actually people who wear the hijab and cover up all their hair are looked down upon. Like, so many times I've been in the car with young people where they're like, oh, how many points do I get if I run over this like person who's, you know, like wearing dress from head to toe and like religious like garments. So it's not at all like, I think, like even in Iran where the rule is to wear a hijab, like, it's more important for young people to be like taking it off. There's a very stronger pull for younger people to be taking it off than keeping it on.
But in the larger scheme of things, the pull of the law is obviously stronger than what's, you know, a few dissenters want to do.
But no, I'm talking about like pulls though, like what you feel socially obliged to do, and where you feel that, like, just like in the United States, like you're, I think, sorry, what's your name? Sarah, that you mentioned. Say, like, you're just talking about how like community and family and friends are pulling you, you know, to like put it on. But again, you can't say that if you live in the United States, you don't constantly know that social, like the social hierarchies in this country are, you do not wear a hijab if you want. Like, even like when I go to Fashion Week, for example, you can tell immediately that people look down on me because I choose to wear a hijab. Like, there's a very clear like social hierarchy that's built that pushes women, especially younger women, to want to take off their hijab in the United States, but also in Iran.
Is it looking down on you, or is it like a legitimate form of confusion? Like, because your hijab is saying one thing, and then you're, you know, at Fashion Week, you're a fashion blogger. To me, that's very, that's contradictory, right? Because
how is it contradictory?
Well, I heard you say in an interview or on a, I think I heard a talk you were doing with Asra, and mm-hmm. there you were asked about why you wear the hijab, and you said that, you know, for you, it's something that keeps you focused and away from the superficialities of life, right? Like, to not focus on outer beauty, things like that. But then fashion.
Well, I think also fashion is more than outer beauty. Fashion is an art. Fashion is a form of self-expression.
Yeah, but that's outer beauty.
But no. I mean, it's art. Like, it's different. I think what I mean by outer beauty is not just like, oh, let me wear the latest trends. That's like, I think outer beauty is a superficial dependence on external affirmation on the way that you look.
But that's, you follow like, hijabi fashion bloggers, right?
But I mean, I follow for aesthetic reasons. Yeah, just like I follow art blogs. I follow Muslim women artists. Like, I think it's an art.
So in
again,
that
like
realm,
I don't think it's like.
In that realm, there will be trends as well, right? So it's not really just necessarily about what's happening in Cosmopolitan magazine. It's about different
realms.
There's
trends everywhere. It's just like what people are, everyone decides to be wearing, what kind of is like inspiring the current. Maybe it's based on political climate. Maybe it's based on, you know, whatever, the season. But I think it doesn't mean that it's necessarily baseless. In fact, I think that calling the fashion industry a shallow industry or something that's just based on just external is like almost anti-feminist, because historically within of, it's always been a very like women-centered and women-dominated industry. And so a lot of patriarchal people always call fashion is like, oh, you know, the shallow little thing because it's dominated by women and women's work is never valued. But I think fashion is very deep and has the potential to be an incredibly powerful and moving force for social change, for art, for aesthetic reasons. So yeah, I think it's important, and I think it makes a lot of sense together.
The hijab and fashion, you mean?
Yeah, definitely.
I'm confused. I'm sorry. I'm older than all of you probably. So, much older. I'd be your mom, probably each and every one of you. But it's just the confusion between I want to cover up and I want to be in public space and I want to look good, but I don't want anybody to see me.
Right.
It's just that I grew up in an extremely open society. Nobody was wearing the hijab until the 1980s when the conservative movement from Saudi Arabia started invading Egypt. And everybody thought it was just a regressive movement and it's never going to catch on because the woman loves to get dressed up, put makeup and everything. It goes against the woman's nature. And we were studying when we were young about the women's liberation movement and how they took off the Turkish Ottoman yashmak, we call it, which is basically the complete cover. But the complete cover came with
Like a burqa, you mean? Like a, the face not, as well?
No,
or?
No, it's not like a burqa. It's just, it's a different, it, well, it it covers completely and it has a white thing on.
But
on
is, the, is the face covered or the face is?
Yes, it is with the white thing. Ugh, it's called yashmak. Anyway, yes, the face is covered, but at the same time, if you want to cover the woman to protect her in the idea of that time, 200 years ago, then the woman stays at home. She doesn't go to school. She doesn't work outside the home. And this is the whole idea, the package of cover, protect. Now, when the Egyptian women took to the street and took off this veil, this yashmak and veil, and expose their hair, expose their faces, and they also demanded the right to vote, the right to go to school, and the right to work side by side with men. They started wearing the European clothes of the time, the fashion of the time, and that was it. Nobody objected on religious grounds. And this is how the women's liberation movement started. And the man learned to accept the woman, respect her, not go crazy and drool if he saw her hair, not faint if he saw her arms, or so. And this developed a culture of mutual respect. When this veil came, when the veil idea came, the implicit agreement that a man cannot control himself, so you gotta cover up, otherwise he'll, you know, go crazy and attack you, and it's your fault. this honor, attaching the honor to what the woman wears, attaching the modesty to the clothes and not to the action, just completely corrupted the morals of the youth. And in Egypt right now, it's the second highest sexual assaults in the world. Mm-hmm. When it was negligible at the before.
I definitely think that that covering and having less exposure to the opposite sex and even their body parts, they're simply like their ankles, their knees, their arms, their elbows, it definitely has a really negative effect. And I can see that in Pakistan too. I mean, we weren't a very overly hijabi and niqabi society either. I remember seeing pictures of my grandma from when she was young. She was like out in public parks in like strapless dresses.
That's right.
And now you cannot even wear like a sleeveless dress.
Yeah.
So things have really changed.
It's the same thing in Egypt, from 0% hijabis in the 1970s and up until 80-82 to right now, it's over 95%. Even the Christians are wearing it because they're scared.
Mm-hmm. And but I mean, also, Christians have always worn the hijab. It's just a different type. Like nuns, for example, like very religious Christian women always wore the hijab. Or even religious Christian
Orthodox women always covered their hair. That's not true. There was a cultural dress that everybody wore. And this was before the women's liberation movement. It was a cultural dress. It had nothing to do with religion. And all the women in the country wore it. And in Turkey as well.
And it's actually in the Bible.
Well, let me just say that. Among Christians.
I've read the Bible.
Hijab in Christianity? Are you kidding
me? Yeah, it asks women to cover their hair. Like, I've read the Bible. Like, but I'm
for,
not.
Okay,
like,
for what reason? For modesty reasons?
I don't usually think that it like spells out exactly why everyone
In any case, even if there is, they're not doing it now because mentally and socially they've come forward into their thinking, separating the woman's sexuality from her clothes, respecting the woman for her actions, not for what she's wearing.
But well, see, that's exactly why a lot of Muslim women choose to wear the hijab. It's because it takes away that focus on how the way that a woman looks and forces people to judge.
But if you want to cover, you cannot be in public. If you want to cover, you cannot be in public because
why can't I be in public?
Let's take a step back. Let's go back to the burkini. And Sarah, let's talk about your piece a bit, because you spoke about how once upon a time you were someone that valued modesty and thought, and you even wore the hijab before, right? Briefly?
Just for a brief amount of time, and I did it by choice. It wasn't, by choice, what I mean is to say, of course, I was in a Muslim community, in a Muslim society, my parents were Muslim, my family's Muslim, so, you know, it made sense to me that this was something that I should do, and I hope that it said something about me as a person. And I think that's what's important, and we touched on that a little bit. I think I actually found that conversation, just the one you two were having, Hala and Hoda, I thought it was very interesting. I think the most important bit is that it's not, you know, unrelated to sexual assault, and I'm glad that that was brought up somewhere in there, that, you know, it doesn't really protect women from assault. And if it means something that a woman chooses to dress a certain way, if it says something about her character, even a positive thing, you know, then it necessarily means something to take it off. It necessarily says something negative about the woman that doesn't. So for me, when, you know, I put it on, I was praised, not by you know, the American society necessarily, but by my Muslim community and my parents. You know, they were amused by it, and they, you know, they thought it was, you know, a fine thing to do. What happened, though, when I started to dress in a more American, in a more Westernized context, you know, where short sleeves, you know, capris, I didn't even wear shorts for a long time. That's when I started receiving, you know, funny looks and abuse, and people started distancing themselves from me, and, you know, comments
here
from
in the
some
United
family
States,
members.
Sarah? Here?
Yes.
Or where?
Yes, here.
From your own family and your own community, is that it?
Yes, and I actually didn't do it much in front of them. You know, I knew what would happen if I went out in capris in front of the community. So I didn't really, and my parents forbade me to dress a certain way in front of people we knew. So it was kind of like living a double life for a long time, until now. Now that I'm an open ex-Muslim, I mean, I'm a lot of people have distanced themselves from me on principle because of who I am and what I stand for.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that, you know, that has to be a part of the conversation, and that has to be considered because women like me, who, you know, choose to perhaps dress a different way, who choose to, you know, reveal a little bit more of their body and not really not feel demeaned by it, we should be included, but we're kind of hidden away because it's sort of a shameful thing to be the, you know, the kind of person that I am.
Yeah, it's so sad. It's so sad that to see the young generation, now you're probably my daughter's age, that it, the exact opposite is what is happening to you now. And this is what, when I talk about the burkini and the fact that it is a symbol of a certain ideology that is harmful to the society, that we need to dissociate. And I don't know whether we ban it or I don't know what is the best way to do it.
But I feel like is happening is that it's just you're defining what liberation is to women. Like,
no,
period.
It's not. Liberation is not wearing a cover.
This is not for you to decide.
Let me read it. It absolutely is.
It has been decided a long time ago. And now in the courts, if somebody said, "I raped this woman because she was wearing a miniskirt," that will not be taken into account. Now, the woman is being respected for who she is, not what she wears. This is not liberation. Liberation from what? If I stood naked and people respected me, that is liberation.
But that's for you. Like, liberation and feminism is about what it means for each individual woman.
Standards. I'm sorry about that.
Now this is Orientalism.
Okay,
now we're
talking
Orientalism.
Can I just stop for a second to read a paragraph from Hala's article about the burkini ban, where she's very pro-burkini ban? It is very difficult to understand the uproar caused by the French government's decision to ban the burkini. This was a reaction to the chaos and turmoil caused by the Islamic fundamentalist sect in the Muslim world and in Europe. The fundamentalists are the ones who reject participation in the 21st century. They prefer to isolate themselves in 7th century ideas and dress. Despite that, no one is denying them the right to practice their religion in private. They don't have the right, however, to invade the public space and impose their ideology and belief system represented by their dress. Now, I agree with some parts of it, but I disagree with a lot of it too. But anyways, sorry to interrupt your conversation before. I just wanted to put this piece out there as the central crux of what you're trying to get across in terms of the burkini. Hoda, you were saying this is Orientalism. Can you expand on that a bit?
Definitely. So Orientalism is basically this concept that the West uses to structure and view the East, particularly Muslims and Islam, for a very clear political purpose. And it's a historic concept that has been that has continued ever since colonialism began. And basically it creates this false dichotomy between modernization and modernism and traditionalism and like Islam. So anytime someone becomes more religious, they're automatically less modern, which is false because it's a linear time that we're working with. But it's like it's saying that nothing like
okay. When you're done, I need to answer that. Today,
anything that happens today right now is modern. Like you can't say that someone is living in the past because they're not. They're living today. And everyone comes through their different particular historical context. So there's a false dichotomy that's created between the West and the East.
But Sharia punishments are not modern just because they're happening today.
But see, it depends on how you define modern. If you define modern as Western, like that's ideology that's coming together. Like, so what Orientalism does is basically it restructures the East, but the key part is it does it so without the consent or without the voice of the East. So it's talking for them. It represents them in a particular light. So for example, this whole burkini ban is centered on that. And this whole idea of what you're talking about, Hala, was about you say that this is like oppressing women, but how can you say that women are being oppressed when they're choosing to do so? For me, when people come up to me, let me help you, liberate you, and take off your hijab. Like, you know, I don't need people to speak for me. Like, it's saying that I am not able to make my own decisions. It's saying that I, as a woman, do not have the mental capacity to make a choice for how I choose to dress. And it's creating just a flat, turning a symbol that has existed for centuries into just a flat, like huge monolithic idea that is different for every woman. There are billions of Muslims
talking
in the world.
Too much. I can't keep up with you. You have a lot of ideas that I need to answer. And if this is going to be a monologue,
let's give Hala a chance.
This is my response to what you've been saying
before.
You have a lot of points. You made a lot of points, and you keep moving from one point to the other. I cannot keep up with you. I need to answer some of your points.
Hala, please answer.
It's a monologue, for God's sake.
I mean, I had been writing these notes as you were talking, so that's why they're all coming out now, because I was responding to all the points that you made earlier.
What points?
Let's just respond to what she's talking about, Orientalism.
This idea about how being modern is being Western, and this is exactly what the Shiuch, the clergy, the old clergy who want to impose their own ideas, keep saying all the time that I've been called a brown colonialist lackey. This is
I think we all, well, I have too.
I'll tell you, from the 7th century, this has been the first thing on their mouth to say they are foreigners. Were called also foreigners and coming with foreign ideas because they studied Greek philosophy, and these are not our norms. We are the East, are different from the West, and that's just nonsense, because whatever part of the world achieves any kind of progress, let's say you don't say that medicine is a Western invention, we're just gonna keep taking our herbs. No, that doesn't happen. So it human beings in general, they move forward they pick up from whoever made progress, and they continue together. They do not keep holding on to 7th century ideas and clothes when we are in the 21st century, regardless of where this these new ideas about women's liberation and human rights, and well, regardless of all of that, where it came from, it is a progress for humanity, and we all join it.
But I didn't get how that was relevant.
Can I butt in?
Please, Sarah, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead, Sarah.
Sorry. Well, it's interesting because I agree with, I agree with both of you on some points and, mm-hmm. and not on others. On the one hand, I'm an ex-Muslim and I have my private thoughts about what I believe the hijab means. And generally, I think it's I think it is oppressive, and I would define it as oppressive, and that's the conclusion that I've come to. But I am anti the ban for some of the reasons that Hoda mentioned, which is that, you know, for individuals it means different things, and there I can't make a claim that for all Western women it necessarily means the same thing. It could be people like her, like Hoda. I mean, but I would categorize you though as somebody who's very privileged in Muslim communities. If it is that you were, you know, truly very free to put it on, and mm-hmm. you don't feel a lot of coercion to put it on, but you may to take it off. Having said all that, the way I define women's liberation isn't that a woman is clothed or unclothed. That is just that she has the choice to do either.
Exactly.
And I think that's the main point that we should be focusing on. So in that sense, I can condemn Eastern societies for forcing a woman to put it on, and I can condemn Western societies for, you know, if they ever choose to force a woman to take it off. And I can equally condemn any coercive forces that exist socially that, you know, especially within Muslim communities, I think they do. And I do condemn them because I think that that's a very important thing in the lives of Muslim women in Western world. And I think we should distinguish between the life of a Muslim woman in an Eastern country mm-hmm. and that in a Western country, because we're talking about the Burkini ban here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think I totally agree. And that's where a lot of I was trying to articulate about what feminism is and what liberation is. And it should be up to the woman to decide, like two men, whether he is a religious man or a secular, quote unquote, man, deciding and determining how a woman should dress when she goes to the beach is completely patriarchal and misogynistic. And so like that's exactly it. Like women should be able to, like, if you view personally that the hijab is oppression, like that's fine for you. Like, you don't have to wear it. That's completely fine. But then you can't, you know, like exactly, you can't take that away from somebody else who has value.
You still did not explain to me what does it mean to you. You just
said. But why is that relevant?
It is relevant.
It is relevant. It is the whole idea, because it is not the piece of cloth. It is what it represents. Do you want to stand out as a Muslim and tell everybody I'm a Muslim, so that's why you're wearing it? Are you ashamed of your body, so that's why you're wearing it? What? Why? My point all along.
But you even, I think you quoted what I said I believed in when you said
I asked you
when I was on Asr Nomani.
Answer.
Oh, but you already told me. You told me why I wore it. Yeah, you said I surged on a panel with Asr
Nomani. No, that was me. That was me, Ina.
Oh, sorry. I haven't distinguished the voices.
Right.
So before we started, I just asked you, and I never got a real answer. Because my piece that I read from now was about the ideology itself. Not the piece of cloth, but what it represents. And that's my whole issue. I am from a generation that worshipped the women that came before us and gave us the opportunity to go to schools and universities and be on equal footing with a man, regardless of what we wear, and not to be judged by what we wear, and not to be expected to cover in order to make the man more comfortable. And the men respected us just equally, regardless of what we wear. So the cover, to me, means going back to before the women's liberation movement.
It may very well be, but I mean, I just, where I disagree with you, Hala, is the is favoring the ban, because even if it is the fundamentalist,
the problem is you probably did not. I went through this before. I went through this idea before, and we said, "Oh, they are free to do whatever they want to do. They are if a woman wants to." And before, actually, in the 80s. The first people, the first women who started wearing it were the economically underprivileged. So it was understood that, oh, well, they cannot go to the hairdresser every week. They cannot change dresses and skirts. So it was understood, and we kind of let it go. And now I wish we had taken a stronger stand, because the situation, as it deteriorated over the past 30, 35 years in Egypt, made me think that maybe if we had the foresight, we would have changed this. We would not have accepted it. Once it becomes part of the public domain, the idea itself becomes so accepted, and the next generation actually grows up like you guys, thinking, oh, it's normal. It is not.
No. I grew up in Saudi Arabia, and I've seen morality police hit my mother's ankle.
Oh, God.
So.
The thing is, when in the 70s, when I was a teenager, the Saudis and the Gulf people used to come to Egypt, and in the airport, they would take off their...
Oh, yeah, I remember that. They'd start
undressing.
They'd walk
around in miniskirts and shorts and everything. And now, the exact opposite.
But here's the thing. Because I've grown up in a place that forces people to be a certain way, to dress a certain way, and especially this quote that, so the mayor of Cannes issued an ordinance in late July forbidding beach wear that doesn't respect good morals and secularism.
Yeah, I've read that quote.
To me, that is a really disturbing kind of way to put it, like this whole good morals thing. It's reminiscent of Islamists, and I know this is not a comparison between how France is like the Saudi Arabia all of a sudden. It's not at all, but I do not want to live in a world where people are forced to dress in a certain way, or forced to undress or take off parts of their clothing. Also, because I come at this as a person who has for much of my young adult life, when I was in university, I dressed, I guess, in an alternative manner. So I wore, like, fishnets and dog collars and had blue spiky hair. And
I remember those days.
Oh, that's lovely. This is your freedom of expression. My daughter does this all the time.
Right.
I get shocked, but then I see how creative it is. And
no, but then society does dictate that type of dress to a certain extent, right? Like if I went into a store, I'd get stares, or people would like follow me to the back of the store thinking I'm going to, I don't know, steal something because of the way that I look. So I've experienced that. And in that way, I can understand how someone who dresses differently, like maybe a hijabi, would feel, even though it's completely the opposite.
But is it, but like, I feel like just like that was your expression. Like, why can't this be my expression? Like, why won't people let me be able to have this as my expression?
Of course,
like,
they should let you. But this is the thing. Your choice comes with a burden, where this is a practice that is used to oppress majority of women wearing it. You are privileged enough to have the choice, but you are continuing to use that choice to perpetuate this practice. I'm opposed to the practice, but I always stand up for your right to wear it, because it doesn't infringe on anybody else, really, rather than maybe being visually offensive or whatever. But, I mean, I stood up for Charlie Hebdo, so I certainly want to be consistent and say that we cannot ban things just because they're offensive. You know what I mean?
Let me just address something that Sarah said and found very interesting to me, that being an ex-Muslim, when the kids in Egypt, after the revolution a couple of years ago, discovered that this whole business about wearing the hijab and becoming religious was just a ruse in order to get to political power, and they took to the streets, and they demanded that the Islamist president be removed, and now they put the army. A lot of girls and boys, a lot of girls took off their scarves, and a lot of boys became atheists and announced it.
Mm-hmm.
Because they all regarded this movement that started in the 80s as a way to control women and also to get some sort of power in the name of the religion to attain political standing in the country. Mm-hmm. And of course, and Iran, you can say that.
Yeah, but actually, it's funny that you mentioned Iran. I was going to say the exact opposite happened in Iran prior to the revolution. So there was a period of mandatory unveiling in Iran, mm-hmm. where women could not have a job. They were not allowed to hold a government office if they wore the hijab, because exactly like what you're saying, they had to look like a westernized quote unquote subject in order to have a job. Under one of the shahs prior to the revolution, there was a period of mandatory unveiling. And women, like even my grandmother, she was walking in the streets, an officer ripped off of her hijab, like violently ripped off her hijab, because she was not allowed to wear it. And so exactly what you're talking about, the opposite happens all the time. And I feel like we often fail to address that or fail to acknowledge this history also that all of these countries have.
Well, the same thing happened with Kemal Atatürk in Turkey, when he just wanted to change the Turkish Ottoman old ways and bring Turkey into the 20th century. So I guess it's connected to the leader's vision of progress. I don't know. But
see, that I think that's Orientalist, because like, how can I say that, I am stuck in the 7th century because I just choose to, instead of wearing a scarf around my neck, I decide to put it on my head. And
no, but where does that come from?
Based on religion.
Where does it come from, that scarf?
Religion, Hoda. It is religion. It is not a
fashion. We can talk about that, about any part of our clothing. Like, so many things are coming from historical, like, places. Or, for example, the Jewish kippah. Like, that is a historical symbol.
I wouldn't say it's the most modern symbol, either.
But why do we never tell, for example, Jewish men who choose to wear that, take it off, you look like you're from the 7th century.
Because he's not wearing it because he's scared I'm going to jump him if I saw his head.
I'm not wearing it because I think men are going to jump for me. I'm saying you're defining a symbol that for so many different women mean different things, and you can't just create or flatten symbols that have such significance.
You guys say it is modesty, so you cannot say it's modesty.
But you guys, like, again, you're drawing very broad generalizations.
It's
very
true. So what do you think then, Hoda? Because you haven't, so, you know, I'm with you that it means different things for different people, possibly, and I'm willing to buy that, but and you're telling us what it doesn't mean for you. You're sort of, you know, bristling against, you know, certain definitions, but then what does it mean? You know, and I think that's the first step.
Yeah, so I think it means different things for different people. So I don't want the reason that I wear it to become the new norm that, you know, for all women wearing for the same reasons. But again, whoever mentioned it earlier, I wear it because it is for me. I like to wear it to kind of not focus on the way that my looks should inform people's judgments about me.
But you're a fashion blogger. That,
yes. Again, yes.
Again.
You're just quoting.
Hoda, you're killing me, baby.
I'm sorry that for you, fashion is a very static and something
it's
that has no
static.
Value. But for me, it has something that has value.
You can be
not focused on outward experiences and find fashion to be a very beautiful, like, powerful tool of communication. They are not at all mutually exclusive, and I'm sorry that you see them that way.
No, I don't. I mean, as I told you, I dress in a very, in a way that was different to most people, and I did use it as a tool of expression and a tool of communication, but I'm not the one here saying that I want to focus on not outward things and not, outward beauty, I guess.
Well, I'm not saying even like, I think so. So the way that I dress and the way that I choose to present myself is for myself, you know, like I choose to wear things because I think something looks good. Or I think either like I wear a lot of clashing patterns all the time.
So are you wearing the hijab because you think it looks good?
No, I wear hijab because, again, like I mentioned three sentences or four sentences ago, because it helps me focus on, or just remind me constantly that it's not about the way that I look. Like, it helps me focus on things that are more important. Fashion, so on the other hand, is a powerful form of communication.
Do you think it's religious or a fashion statement? That's my point.
It's very, well, I
want to know that.
But I think, so if you let me finish my sentence, I would love to answer you.
Please do.
I think that's exactly what my religion is asking me to, and your religion as a Muslim, but that's my opinion. Yeah. Again, like, I'm not going to say
that. Not my religion, I'm sorry. This is your interpretation.
But then let me finish. I'm just saying, as a Muslim, this is what I believe Islam is. Okay, I'm not going to create a flattened symbol like you are, but I'm saying that if you're going to ask me a question, let me finish it.
Please go.
For me, again, Islam does not want people to be focusing on material things, on the immediate, on outward experiences, but kind of more on knowledge and understanding and things like this. So I think it's very directly linked to religion, but so we're hiding from men. Like, that's absolutely absurd. Like, I'm a feminist. Like, that would be ridiculous.
But didn't you say modesty?
Sarah.
I never said the word modesty.
I'd love to hear your thoughts on the fact that it's linked to religion, but not necessarily from religion.
Well, I think this back and forth. It's just, I have so many things to say, but I don't want to butt in because it's just, everyone's just all these points flying everywhere. But I think, so the way that I would interpret what Hoda was saying, which is to say what I would have meant if I was a fashion blogger who was also a hijabi, I wouldn't necessarily be that, you know, I'm trying to be as charitable as possible to her understanding. I would say that, I wear the hijab because I don't necessarily want, not that I don't want any focus at all on appearances, because, you know, obviously aesthetics are interesting and can be stimulating and, you know, not related to beauty, but not necessarily about beauty. But I don't want to be sexualized. That's what I would have said. And that's how I did interpret the hijab, which is not to say that I can't be pretty necessarily, but I can't be sexually alluring, which is sort of a different conversation. And mm-hmm. I think that I think a lot of hijabis would, and I don't know about Hoda, I'm not speaking for her, but I think a lot of hijabis would agree with that it's the sexual allure part that's sort of what they don't want. And I think it's perfectly fine for an individual to not want that, but then you must simultaneously say that the women who don't dress a certain this way aren't, you know, asking for it, because I think that's a logical conclusion of that thought process. Mm-hmm. If you say that, you know, I'm wearing it because, you know, I don't want this sexual kind of attraction, then you must say, but let's not lead to this next step, which is essentially slut shaming, or you know, victim blaming. So let's not go there. And that's what I would like to see, because I'm an ex-Muslim who stood for hijabis to keep it on, and, you know, it can mean what it means to them. I'll speak out against that symbol, and I'm free to do so. And I would hope that they would also speak for me and women like me and say mm-hmm. that, well, they're not, you know, they are not modest, but this doesn't mean XYZ for them, which is why I think it's so important.
Definitely.
But here's the thing.
I think that's so important, because, like, but we have to also acknowledge that sort of conversation, that kind of she asked for it, which is absolutely awful, is happening in the United States all the time. Like, I just graduated from the University of Chicago, and there we would constantly see, like, rape cases.
But it's not
acceptable.
It's not to say
sexually assaulted. Constantly, they would be like, oh, she asked for it. So I'm not saying that, like, I'm 100% against
it. Nobody's doing something about it in order to stop it in terms of covering women up. It's not an accepted
argument. No one's doing anything about that in the United States. In fact, if you go to the Stanford case, it got off. In fact, the father sent a letter saying, oh, my poor son. And
yes,
then he got less.
So here's the thing. We're against it.
I'm not familiar with that. But I know that the courts are not going to accept she is wearing this, so she was asking for it as a defense. I don't know the specifics of the case that you're talking about.
Massive in the United States. I mean, like, as many of my friends who have been raped for the fact that they, or like, that's how it's perceived. Like in the University of Chicago, it's constantly like, well, what was she wearing? You know, that's always usually the first
question. But do you not see the link to that and modesty clothing? Do you not see that this helps to perpetuate that? Systemic.
I don't think that wearing or like women choosing to dress modestly necessarily makes other women like brings that culture. I think it's a patriarchal culture that forces women to wear a specific thing. I'm 100% against that,
but which religion. Is why, again,
I also condemn mandatory hijab. Like, as I mentioned in the beginning, I also condemn mandatory unveiling.
Yeah, but that's really like a basic, like someone saying, oh, I condemn Trump. Like, that's really the most obvious thing that you can condemn. You got to go a step beyond that, though, because you are doing your part in keeping this practice going.
But I also, like as I mentioned, like, this is, like, I am constantly saying that I think that feminism and liberation is based on one woman's choice. So for me, that's for me. Let me finish. For me, it's wearing, choosing to wear a headscarf. For another woman, it's choosing to wear the bikini, and that is 100% okay with me.
Okay.
And I'm going to fight for that woman's right to wear whatever she wants because that's her choice. That's
but what you feminism. See that the religion that you follow does not fight for that right. Because modesty is recommended. Bikinis are not compatible with Islam.
But I mean, I think it's unfortunate that there are communities that look down upon the bikini, but also not just Muslim communities. It's a
right.
larger.
But I'm,
so, but I, and I think that's...
But
that's,
we're all Muslim background women, so we're going to talk about our experiences and the religion we were born into, because it's the most familiar, right? So mm-hmm. saying that you stand up for women in bikinis... But you practice a religion that doesn't stand up for women in bikinis, in fact, condemns them and asks them to be modest. You know, it's very contradictory. And then this idea that no sexualization, and that's why people wear the hijab. However, I think it's actually sexualizing people because, I mean, it's drawing attention to the idea, especially when they put it on kids. I mean, it's to me, it's the equivalent of putting them in a shirt that says slut or something. You know, it's that distasteful.
Right. I find putting it on children pretty bizarre, especially young, you know, babies. You'll see 4-year-olds girls with hijab, and I don't understand that at all.
I think it's also kind of a ridiculous claim to say that I am kind of encouraging or kind of helping to create a culture that slut shames women, whereas we're not talking anything about how horrible, like, the porn industry directly does that. You know, like, me, how can, like...
Hoda, it's not religious. When it's backed by religion,
exactly.
It's a totally different beast.
But you can't say that my choice to wear one thing, like I am directly responsible through my own choice to dress myself, is going to change other way. Then why don't we also say,
Do you believe that God mandated it?
Can I finish my sentence before you interrupted me? Well, now I forgot what I was going to say.
Okay, can you answer me?
I don't
because
believe hijab is mandatory.
You keep talking about choice.
Well, the thing is, it's so vague that there are many different interpretations of Islam, too. And we can see right on this panel here, we have Hala, who interprets Islam completely differently and says she's a devout practicing Muslim, but is for the burkini ban. And then we have you, who is, someone who stands up for bikinis and enjoys fashion, but also wears the hijab. And that would be completely different from someone who kind of preaches modesty and wants it enforced on other people. There's so many different ways that people practice Islam. So
exactly.
I totally
that's
get
the moral
that.
Of the panel
no,
is that there's
there
a plurality
is, no.
of religion, there's a plurality of views, there's a plurality
there
of individualism,
but it's one,
feminism,
it's,
liberation.
No, but the one that wears the hijab says
Sarah?
That God says the hijab.
You just asked someone who wears the hijab, and the person who just wears the hijab.
And you didn't answer.
I
give Sarah
twice.
A chance to speak because I feel like she's being very polite and
go
holding
ahead,
back.
Sarah,
go ahead, Sarah.
You're wonderful.
Sorry. Well, thank you, Ina, for like holding my hand. But I think I mentioned this a little bit earlier, and I want to bring this conversation back to this. We have to be able to separate individual experiences from aggregate. And I think it's perfectly fine to say that Hoda was, empowered in her putting on the hijab, and that there are many women who are. But can we at least acknowledge that in the aggregate,
In many Muslim communities, far too many Muslim communities, there is too much of a pressure to, you know, define yourself by what you're wearing. And it definitely defines to the extent to which you're a religious person. And I think that's where Hala's question about, you know, does the religion mandate it comes into play? Because would the average hijabi say that a woman who doesn't cover is practicing her religion just as well or as well as she is, you know?
Yeah, it's very disingenuous for me to take this argument into it's a fashion statement. It's just like a ring or an earring mm-hmm. or a bracelet. I can put it on or take it off whenever I want with no consequences. That's not how it is.
I agree with
Hala. And with the children, they tell them if you don't wear it, you're going to go to hell. God wants you to do that. And then they say it's a choice. How is it a choice? And you say it's mandated by God.
See, I think that goes back to our first discussion when I said that for me and for many other Muslims and the countless statistics and surveys that prove this in the United States, there's a larger push for Muslim women to be taking off the hijab than putting it on, especially in a lot of Western countries.
I will never tell you take it off.
Okay,
Here's the thing, people don't understand.
You're not like this society, you know, like by saying that, you know, like this is my experience is also like not an individual. I'm saying like this is proven by statistics, surveys, like countless communities are coming out and saying these things. Like it shows that, yeah,
surveys?
I agree that there is pressure
to wear it,
but there's also pressure to take it off.
Surveys are saying that there's more pressure for people to take off the hijab than put it on.
Honor brigades into consideration? Honor brigades?
Yes, when we talk about...
They're organized.
Okay, well, I'll just let you finish since you're not letting me finish.
Okay, go ahead.
Are you sure?
All right, just this time.
Wow, you're so kind and generous. Thank you.
Yeah, that's me.
So when we're talking about pressures or society, we have to be specific about where we are talking about this, okay? We have to be very specific. In Iran, my research shows, many other things that I've been reading, many other countless scholarship shows that there is pressure for women to be taking it off amongst young people.
But that is not comparable to the pressure to put it on. That's all I'm saying.
But it is, though. Like, if you go to Iran and you walk around, more women have the hijab dangling around their shoulders, just, like, not wearing it the way that the government wants it, than women are wearing it the way that the government wants
it. That's not because of pressure. That's because of a natural desire to want to feel the sun in your hair or something. I mean, have you seen this page called My Stealthy Freedom?
I have seen it. Yes, I have.
I mean, don't you think that speaks to a certain type of pressure? Like... That's being put on women in Iran where they have to make a Facebook page where they're posting pictures of themselves taking their hijabs off?
I mean, I'm just refuting the point that in every single situation and every single like part of the world, there is more pressure for Muslim women.
No. I never said every single situation.
I mean, but when you're saying there is a pressure period, it's a very general statement that is automatically applied. When we don't specify where you're talking about or what group of people.
No, I mean on the whole, in the world, there is more pressure to put the hijab on, to put modesty covering on for Muslim women than there is to take it off. I mean,
that is
a true statement. This cannot be refuted at all.
I agree with you in terms of women having the choice. As I said, I don't agree with Hala being pro burkini ban, even though swimsuit, you know, growing up in Saudi, we lived in a compound. It was a Western compound. For a long time, there weren't even Saudis allowed in my compound. So we would swim freely doing whatever. Women would bathe topless at the pool in my compound. And then slowly, Saudis were starting to be allowed in to live in our compound. And then compound life changed all of a sudden. Women used to be able to drive. All of a sudden, they weren't allowed to drive. And then they started
segregating. Ridiculous.
Yeah, they were segregating swimming timing. So, I mean, women had a time to swim, and then men had a time to swim, and then it was like a family time to swim. And then we started seeing more and more Islamic swimsuits. Like, I would never even look at the schedule. Like, I would just go swim because I'd swim a lot. So, I mean, sometimes I'd have to leave because it was the guy's time. And, you know, it really upset me because I wasn't used to that at all. But then in the women's time, I'd see all these like burkinis still, right? And I guess it's because even though it was women's time, there was a male lifeguard around. And it was something that was foreign to me growing up in Saudi Arabia. It was strange. I mean, it's just a weird thing to see coming out of the water. If you ever see it, it's not very practical. It looks like a choking hazard. And there's water.
No, I just want to be completely clear. From a fashion standpoint, the only complaint I have about the burkini is that it could look much more aesthetically more pleasing.
But I don't know how you would make it.
Isn't it confining? Who tried it? Did anybody try it? Isn't it suffocating?
I mean, obviously women choose to wear it and go bathing, so.
But also there's a thing of the water, right? Even though it's loose and stuff, once you start coming
out. Is it loose?
It's in the beginning it's loose, and then you get in the water and then it all sticks to you. It seems even to.
Is it like a wetsuit? Like the diving wetsuit?
It's not elasticated like that.
You should have brought someone on this panel who actually wears the bikini.
I did. What do you think? Did you wear it, Oda?
No, I've never worn it.
No, I tried with five different women, or six maybe, that wear a hijab, and some of them wore a burkini. I can't tell you how many times I was rejected, politely, but rejected, because I always wanted to be upfront about the fact that I'm ex-Muslim, and I want to have this conversation. So, you know, thank you so much for being open to having this conversation, because if we don't have these conversations, we're not going to get anywhere. And, I mean, six women said no to me. So here we go. I'm glad we have someone that has some experience wearing religious modesty clothing. But, I mean, here's the thing. There's so many reasons women wear the hijab, as we were talking about before, right? And so there might be so many reasons women wear burkinis, too. So I do get a bit annoyed at the people on Twitter telling me, well, you know, this is a symbol of Islamism and we must ban it because they're forced into it. And I mean, there could be people with body image issues. There could be people this is the only way they get out. If they had a choice, they wouldn't wear it. So why not give them that chance?
I think the word choice, it's an interesting word. I mean, what do we really mean by choice? And I mean,
it's true,
right? It's hard to define exactly what that means. And in a Muslim context, and in a context where, you know, the community is so powerful, it's such a powerful influence on how you choose to behave in a close knit, sort of usually isolated communities that Muslim communities are. I think choice is a very it's a very interesting term, and it's not as clear exactly how much choice you have, anything to do one way or another. Having said that, we still have to legally say that it is a choice, because we cannot say that because you are strongly socially coerced to do X, we will free you by taking it off. Mm-hmm. Because you could say that about you know, hundreds, thousands of things that parents do to children. You know, mm-hmm. There's so many things that parents force their children to do one way or another, and you could call all of that coercion, and you can call much of it harmful to them. You know, if you wanted to make that case. But what place does the state have to make that distinction, and mm-hmm. should they be making it? And I would argue no. But having said that, I think it is something that concerns somebody like me when you see, you know, many more women. I saw after 9/11, I saw many more women that started to cover in general mm-hmm. than before. You know, I noticed that even women in my family, I noticed that suddenly people started to put it on. And it is something that concerns someone like me, because I think that there are, whether or not, you know, one or two people out of 10 think that it means something different, many people do think it has to do with modesty. And that has practical consequences as, you know, religiosity increases within the community, unless someone's willing to say, you know, or stand for and say, you know, this doesn't make any sense. This doesn't free women. But I agree that it's a problem, quote unquote, but I,
the way that I think that it should be handled. You know, so I agree with Hala, which I agree with what it represents. I agree with her. That's the conclusion that I've come to as well. That generally speaking, that's what it means on a broader societal scale. Having said that, I don't agree with her of how we should handle it. I think we should, you know, tackle it at its root, which is to say that a lot of these women, I mean, Hoda is here and she believes it means certain things. So if I wanted to convince her that this wasn't the right way, I would have a discussion. You know, I would talk about it and I would try and convince her and persuade her to my point of view. And I think that is the best way of handling this situation, if you think it is a situation that needs to be handled.
Well, forcing her won't change her mind. No,
I wouldn't want to convince her one way or the other. She's free, and I definitely believe in her freedom to do whatever she wants and to wear whatever she wants and to believe in whatever religious interpretation she likes. But what I'm saying is that this is a religious belief based on whatever, fundamentalist or whatever. They're free to believe what they like. However, experience has shown in the past 30 to 35 years that practicing this on a larger scale in any society brings the woman, demeans the woman, and gives an implicit okay for men to attack her sexually. So it is a harmful ideology that we do not want to mix in public in this day and age.
But I'm also against anti-Muslim bigotry and hijab is...
Here's another thing. To say that this people who oppose this are Islamophobic is just also inaccurate.
Yes, I agree with that.
Because they are not. I mean, the hijabis are one sect with a strict interpretation of Islam. They do not represent all Muslims. So if it is a phobia...
But then you're representing all of us as one single being.
No. If anybody,
you just said we all have a strict interpretation of Islam. You
it
just
is.
Said that
nobody
would be a flat
ever came up,
interpretation
nobody
of like,
ever came
all of
up
our interpretations
with
of Islam.
This hijab, okay. Except this sect that came out in the 1980s. This never existed before.
No, the hijab definitely existed prior to the 1980s.
If it existed, it was a cultural dress. It was not a religious dress. It was a cultural dress worn by everybody, Muslims, Christians, and Jews at the same time. We had Jews and Morocco had Jews, and they all dressed in the same
way. But another thing we need to talk about,
not religiously,
is the persecution and the harassment that hijabis do face. I don't think that banning this will curb that.
That's what I'm... I don't know if banning it is that... I don't know if it's effective, if it... I don't know, but all I know is that you cannot make it part of the everyday scene. You cannot make it an accepted, just like all of Europe.
Like you just told me you'll be okay with me and my choice to wear it, but you just said it can't be at a public scene. So clearly you're just saying I can't wear it in public.
No, you cannot.
You're just, you are respecting my choice
just
to wear
like
it.
Just like the swastika. The swastika, by law, is banned all over Europe.
I think that's wrong.
Yeah, I wouldn't agree with that.
You guys are crazy. You're nuts.
Because then where does it stop? Like, just because one group of people have a view that's different than yours doesn't mean you have to ban everything else. That's fascism.
No.
That's the definition of fascism.
There are ideas that are destructive to the society.
Based on who? Like, you can't just, like, these are all your opinions. Like, I have other ideas that I think other people's views are destructive to society, but that doesn't mean I'm going to ban them from
anything that
political.
Anything that encourages rape or mass murder is definitely
I think it's
a destructive idea.
I mean,
all right,
you can't
hold on,
say,
you guys.
No.
Hold on. I'm older. I'm going to pull rank here. What if a Roma... You know, the gypsies came back and said, oh, we believe in our old tradition of community property. We frown upon personal property. And from here on in, we're going to go and shoplift whatever we want. Will this be an accepted ideology?
Here's the difference, though. When it starts to impact somebody else, like I am I guess, more on board with what you're saying when it comes to the niqab. And this is the thing that's frustrated me about this burkini discussion, is that people seem not to grasp the nuances, right? So either they've seen that I'm opposed to religious modesty clothing, but then that I'm also opposed to the ban. People don't understand how you can be both. And it's really so simple. You can be opposed to an idea intellectually, and you can also uphold the rights for the women that abide by this religious code. You can be opposed to it while also being opposed to a ban. Do you understand? Like, it doesn't have to be one or the other.
No, I understand. And I'm not saying that the ban is definitely the way to go, but I just do not want this religious garb that causes.
But then this ban will encourage people and make them feel like they're dissenting and they're martyrs and they're victims. And as
I would
say,
well, if let's put the Jewish Orthodox women, they wear their own strict cover-ups, but at the same time they stay in their own little world, and the same thing should go for the Muslims who wear the hijab.
So you're saying women who choose to wear a particular race should be oppressed and stay only within
not
their
oppressed,
homes? You said they shouldn't come in the public sphere? Is that
Hoda,
not the most,
you
like, patriarchal?
Yourself from the society.
Okay, we're all talking at
like,
the same
that's
time.
Ridiculous.
It is
Sarah, you said something
is
in the
your
middle.
Idea of separating yourself from the 21st
century. Please do not put my words in my mouth.
Okay, stop. We're not, like, nobody's going to understand this. That's the problem. When you both speak at the same time, it's just like wasted conversation, right? Sarah, you were saying something. You said you would have put it on?
I said, if somebody had banned, banned me from wearing the hijab when I was younger, mm-hmm. I would have put it on in protest. I would have been one of those women that would have said, you can't tell me what to do, and I'll do this.
Yeah.
And I would have done it just for that point and nothing else, because I'm, you know, I'm quite a contrarian. But
yeah.
I think that, you know, we're talking about two different things, and it's very important that we address them separately. So it's one thing to talk about whether or not hijab is a destructive symbol
exactly.
or not. And it's another to talk about, okay, if it is a destructive symbol, how is it that we as a society handle this? And I think that no matter what, you do not, if you disagree with a symbol, banning it does nothing, because it is a symbol. It stands for an ideology, and it's that ideology that you have to dismantle that underpins that symbol. And that's
true.
The important thing. And if you force women to take it off, all you're doing is so if I was, so I have some family members who are, you know, a little bit more extreme. Some, a lot of women I know whose families are a little bit more extreme. If they had been forced to take off their hijab, or, you know, not wear a burkini or whatever it is, then that would just be a somewhere that they could now not go. And they would just be a little bit more secluded, a little bit more hidden. There's many ex-Muslim women too, who are, who have to pretend to be Muslim for the sake of their safety, or until they find financial independence from their family. And those women, or questioning women, or whatever it is, liberal women, they have to put it on, and they have few freedoms. And if we say that this symbol, or anyone with this symbol, is no longer welcome in the public space, then you're essentially saying that these women have to be excluded. And I think that is just the exact wrong way to go about it, because I think it's very important that Muslim communities are integrated well into mainstream societies, that they have relationships and,
You're right. But I think that they have excluded themselves. Nobody excluded them by not joining the 21st century and insisting on a very strict religious dress with sexual connotations. They themselves have separated themselves.
It's funny that you mentioned this in regards to France, whereas France has a history of centuries of brutal colonialization and imperialism with Morocco and Algeria. And so it's not even just like
colonialism again.
Because we can't strip histories and context from particular current
you want history? Let's talk about the hijab history in Saudi Arabia.
Do we think that this is really like a colonialist ploy for France to oppress Muslims.
Let's go back to the colonial brown people.
Okay, now when we, this is the thing about the different degrees of it, right? People seem to either think that niqabs should also be a completely free choice, which I disagree, because then it starts to impact other people's safety and security. I've been very vocally anti-niqab and not necessarily pro a complete ban, but I think partial bans are definitely very reasonable in terms of ID or in schools or at the workplace, because the bare minimum you got to do is see somebody's face at work or while driving or in court. What do you think, Hoda, about the niqab and possibly asking people to show their face in certain places?
Yeah, so I think the burqa ban and the niqab ban actually comes, it seems like it has led the way for what we see now with the burkini ban. Because once you start that initial start of limiting women's choice and autonomy over their own bodies, where do we stop?
Hold on.
See, again, every time I start speaking, she interrupts me. Like, what am I supposed to do?
You know where that started, though? It started with the niqab. That's what's limiting women's choices, though. That's one thing you're failing to call out here.
So you're saying there's no sane woman in this world who chooses to wear the niqab. Is that what you're saying?
Chooses? There's no non-extremist woman in my mind that would choose to wear the niqab. No.
But you can't just like say that, because there's so many women who do choose that.
I've seen hijabis choose it for identity reasons. I've seen hijabis choose it because they're having a bad hair day. I've seen women wear the hijab because they've gained weight. I honestly have. And then when they lose weight, all of a sudden it's like the hijab has come off and they're wearing like spaghetti strap tank tops. And then if they gain weight again, the hijab is back on. It's very strange. I've seen hijabis.
But I mean, like, that's what I'm saying. Like, it's a woman's choice how but she should be able to relate and how she should be able to cover, and when she chooses to cover, and when she chooses to take off her clothing. It's her choice.
Yes.
And that's what feminism is. That's what autonomy over your body is at the end of the day. And that's what I think we should all be fighting for.
But you can't choose to put other people's security at risk, though. I mean, your choice has to stop when it starts to impact other people.
But it doesn't put, like, the amount, the percentage of women in France who wear the niqab or burqa is incredibly small. And of those, how many times has there been... What principle? The principle of a woman being able to choose how she dresses?
And cover herself, her face?
No, the principle of a dress harming the society and causing unnecessary... panic, whatever. It's not safe.
If I can just quickly comment on that, you are now making women's bodies responsible for representing the morality of society, which is the exact same thing that you're fighting against in Saudi Arabia, saying that, for example, a woman needs to be covered in order to show that her society is moral. Exactly that.
I'm not talking about morality. I'm talking... Who said morality?
You said safety.
I said safety.
It's relevant to the society. So by saying that women should now be the flag bearers...
It's nothing to do with women, though. No, you know how many men have put on the burqa and committed robberies and terrorist acts? It's happened in Pakistan and it's happened in Toronto. We've had a jewelry store robbery where the people were in burqas.
But see, like, it's, for example, in France.
So this is not necessarily about women. This is about not allowing people constant anonymity. Constant.
But see, like, the thing about France in particular is that it's not across the board. See, for example, right now in France, on the beaches specifically, a lot of Chinese women are wearing masks called like face kinis or something like that look exactly like ski masks. Okay, you look up pictures, like exactly like a ski mask. They're covering their face because they don't want their face to get any darker, because they, you know, a lot of Chinese cultural images of beauty are someone who has a very light skin. Why has that never been a problem?
No,
why
is
that
also
not coming under attack? Like, it's a very particular, it's like a group of people. It's also women.
So I would be against that too.
It comes with Oriental colonial baggage. It comes with imperialist baggage. It also comes with misogynistic baggage. Oh, and I think that's all working together. Like, we cannot strip colonial history.
This is from the 7th century argument. The colonialism?
Yes. It's like you're telling, it's like you're telling black people in the United States to forget that they were enslaved. Like, that's because it led to a very particular economic situation, which leads to very different things.
But Hoda, what else is enslaving a group of people here? It's this black body bag. Why do you not talk about that?
At first I was like, what are you talking about? It's like, who's wearing black?
Look, I draw that distinction. Can you see that there's a difference between asking women to remove their hijab? I'll respect their choice. But in a bank, asking a woman to remove her face covering, or in a court where they need to see her face? I mean,
I think for legal procedures, for example, for an ID, I think it makes complete sense for someone to ask to see their face.
What about a bank?
Now, for me in the United States, when I was taking my passport photo, they refused to let me take my passport photo until I showed my ears, as if my ears will change or make or break the way that I look when I'm crossing the border.
This is the fingerprints. Yehuda. This is another thing, an identifying factor.
9 out of 10 photos of women, their hair is covering.
This isn't
their
attacking
ears. I'm saying that there should be standards. Yes,
they won't let me wear
IDs. Should show their face. That's an important part of being able
to recognize ears. But they regard the ears as an identifying, because nobody's ear, your ears are different from mine. Everybody's, they're like a fingerprint, and that's why they insist on showing the ear. And you also have to tilt your face.
They won't let you wear glasses if your glasses reflect. They won't let you wear like a piercing stud if your stud reflects. They won't let you smile. This isn't really just about attacking Muslims. Trust me. I did eventually take my
passport photo without my ears showing, and it's completely fine because I'm never going to be passing through customs.
This is another thing. Sure. All of the hijabis want to break the law, and they want the society to accommodate them. And that's another thing that I don't like, and I think harmful to the society. You all have got to update me. I'm not supposed to follow your rules in any way.
I don't understand this. It's the way they wear a dress. It's simple.
Okay, what? Sarah.
Hi.
Hi. Welcome.
There's an interesting point to be made about, you know, to what extent should we accommodating religion? And I think it's fair to say that if we across the board say we are not going to accommodate religion at all, which is to say, you know, if Sikhs can't wear turbans and Muslim women can't wear hijabs, you know, and it's all, you know, on the same playing field. I mean, I think that's
like
that's,
France did. No symbols, no religious symbols at all. This is what France did.
It's fair to say that, you know, this rule applies to everybody, and it's fair to say that we don't want face, but anywhere there isn't a ski mask, anywhere a ski mask would be very inappropriate, or people would be upset, or whatever it is at the presence of a ski mask, a face veil would also be inappropriate. If I was a store owner, I wouldn't want a man in a ski mask to be coming in, and in the same way, I might not want a woman with a face veil coming in.
Exactly.
And I think that makes perfect sense. And I don't think that has anything to do with a special religious discrimination. It may impact a particular religion more so than other religions, but that's irrelevant. Rules are rules, and they do protect everyone. Having said that, I do think something like the burkini, that's almost discrimination against Muslims. That's not a rule that they made for everyone. That's one they made particularly for Muslims in order to counter Islamism, which is, I mean, of course, it's ridiculous. But also, that's a line that I can't stand by, because I don't think that it should be, you shouldn't accommodate them, but you also shouldn't target them especially.
Mm-hmm. Especially when, wetsuits are freely allowed and they cover pretty much the same amount of skin. So,
I'll just say one thing from my experience. When you accommodate this attire with this ideology, it becomes part of the norm, and it causes harm to the society. by giving men the okay to assault women sexually, because it's their duty to cover up themselves. And if anything... Oh, that's
I thought you were finished. Go ahead.
I let you speak. I left you.
I know. I paused. I thought you were finished. I apologize. Go ahead.
I was taking my breath. I'm old. Okay. I lost my train of thought. Go ahead.
Okay. So, what I was saying is I think that, again, blames women on the exact opposite side. So the same thing of going and saying,
blaming women. I'm blaming
religion. Oh, see, religion. Now you interrupted.
Religion. I'm blaming you.
No, but you said that.
I'm blaming the ideology. I'm not blaming the woman. I'm on the woman's side.
Except when they choose to cover themselves. Then you're no longer on the woman's side. You're on the men's
side. No, I'm on her side. On her side to assert herself and to tell the man, I could do whatever the hell I want to do, and you do not have the right to assault me, or I'm not supposed to cover because you're too weak to control yourself.
Again, I never said that was the reason I wore the hijab.
But it is the reason everybody else is wearing the hijab.
That it's prescribed, though, right?
I'm sure there are women who wear the hijab for that reason. Let me finish.
I don't know where you get those women from.
Okay, so the same reason why other women choose to wear different things, just like, for example, some women wear, they wear different things for different meanings. So exactly why we cannot say that one religion prescribes this for a particular way, when it is specifically not mentioned that you wear hijab in the Quran, wear hijab for this reason, period. That's not the reason. So it's up to interpretation.
No, the modesty is mentioned. It is mentioned. And it's vaguely mentioned.
Women are both mentioned, yes. That is correct.
But there is no definition. It's a general term. And what defines modesty in different times are different dresses.
Yes, but they say something like...
I am completely modest. I personally... I'm very, very modest.
But why do you have to be?
Why are you modest?
What?
Why do you dress modestly?
I wear escada and I
wear... No, why?
Why? Because when I go to work. But if I go to a wedding, for example...
Why do you want to dress modestly at work?
Because that's the dress code.
Well,
I am not asking them. This is the dress code. And I follow the dress code. I do not go in, try to work as a stewardess, for example, and then say, I'm not going to serve alcohol. Let the other kids do it and, pick up the slack because of my religious duties. If there is a dress code, I will conform to the dress code. And the modesty as defined today.
I want to express and show my body and not show my body. Like, I guess I have more decision. Like, I'm more particular about how I want the public
religion
to
part
consume
is the fact
my body.
The
Sarah, you were going to say something?
Yeah, I wanted to ask Hoda a question. So we're talking about, what it means, and you're sort of pushing back. You're saying that it, means that different things for different people. Do you think it's unfair? And I just want to get it cleared out, just clearly. Would you think it's unfair to say that there is a pattern, a pervasive pattern of the hijab being equated with a woman's purity? Do you think that this isn't enough of a problem to be addressed? I mean, would you say that it's completely unfair, and for every woman it's a completely different thing?
So, for example, I think it's different based on different contexts. For your example, in Iran,
we're making generalities.
But you can't make generalities. That's my whole argument.
You're like Mercury. You're just getting away every time somebody.
We don't have to say that for an individual woman, this means X. That's not what we're saying at all. Part of addressing social concerns, part of addressing social ills is to identify that they exist in, significant amounts. That's all we're saying. So we're not saying that for you, it means
anything. But where? Like, I want to be specific because, like, as someone who does research
in Muslim societies as a whole, but let's just aim it, for example, let's just aim it just in the Western world, because we don't want to discuss
discuss. I don't want to discuss the East anyway. But let's talk about the Western Muslim communities. Would you say that it's unfair to say that there is a pervasive tendency within Muslim communities to equate the hijab with purity, or do you say that that does not exist?
I think it exists to a certain degree.
Right. And so this is what I think the pushback on the hijab is, which is that, yes, for us, you know, individuals here and there, and for privileged women, and for, you know, and we're, I'm happy for them. I'm happy that they have the choice, that they are not affected by this pervasive tendency. But many are, far too many are. I don't know about most. I don't know about numbers exactly, but I know it's enough that it is something that we should be concerned about. So what I'm not seeing enough is, you know, women who choose to be modest, hijabis who choose it as a choice, are also standing up, also pointing out that this pervasive tendency exists, and then fighting against it.
I see it all the time. I see Muslim women who wear the hijab and Muslim women who don't wear the hijab fighting for feminism, fighting as feminists all mm-hmm. the time, for women's right to choose how they want to dress. I see that all the time.
Oh, well, I mean, I would disagree with that, because I think it's still so strong.
I mean, maybe
when I do hear hijabis speak out, it's about, you know, World Hijab Day. But then when there was, you know,
I'm against World Hijab Day, actually, personally.
Oh, you are?
Mm-hmm.
Why would you say that?
I think the intentions for World Hijab Day is having people experience what it feels like to be a Muslim, but for, like, in the sake of solidarity. But I just don't think that's what solidarity to the Muslim community looks like, because just, like, you shouldn't have to, quote unquote, experience what it feels like to be a Muslim in order to have empathy. Like, it's not like, for example, like, there's not a go around, like, have blackface for a day. You know, that's just wrong. Like, people should be, you know, it's ridiculous. Like, I should have sympathy, and I should have be able to work in solidarity.
Do you see hijabs as equivalent to blackface?
No, not at all.
No, in other
Absolutely
words,
not. But I'm saying that, as it was probably a bad example, but I'm saying, like, we don't have to be and experience the same thing that the communities are experiencing that we want to be in allyship with. Like, I don't have to experience or change the way I look in order to experience what it feels like in somebody else's life, in order to show that I can be in solidarity with them. That's what I'm saying.
Well, especially not if it's like some sort of a purity, chastity belt like idea, right? I mean, that's how I see it. When people
from my experience, when these things started happening in Egypt in 1980s, and this was part of the indoctrination to make it part of a normal, everyday, accepted part of the society. This is how eventually, I mean, it took over.
So what do you think is the best way of addressing this, the gradual creep, you know?
I don't know. I really don't know. I know that it is that what happened over the past 30 years, and I've read all of the social studies that came with trying to interpret why are women going back to address that the women in the 1919 took off as a symbol of oppression and segregation. It's very difficult. I don't know when something, you know, that's why theocracies are the most difficult forms of government to get rid of, is that when you tell people something is happening because of religion, it's impossible to just try to talk rationality to them, because with religion comes complete faith belief. So what do we do? I don't know. Is banning the way to go?
Again, aren't you religious,
I don't know,
yourself?
What?
Aren't you religious yourself?
Yeah, but I do not believe. And when the women in 1919 took off the Turkish Ottoman, see, now you're saying religious. The religious people of Al-Azhar, they never objected on any religious grounds. They never said that everybody knew this is a cultural dress, not a religious dress. And the women took it off. They refused the Ottoman Empire dress, and they started going to school, working with men and everything. We have in Al-Azhar, there is a school for girls in Al-Azhar, and they are all sitting on their desks, not a single one wearing a scarf, not even, I mean, hijab, which did not it was not in the vernacular of the Egyptians or anybody else in the Middle East, for that matter. And the teacher is standing there. He's a clergy wearing the traditional clergy clothes, and he never said, you know, hey, girl, cover up.
Since Hoda has to leave, I'm just going to try and stick
one. No, Hoda, don't leave.
I'm sure you, everyone will be the most upset.
We have gone overestimated time. I knew this would be a really interesting and heated discussion that would never have ended in an hour, but I was going to try. Anyways, my last question to you, Hoda, is this. What have you thought, and I guess Sarah too, what have you guys thought about the Olympics headlines lately? What I noticed was there was a big glorification of hijabi athletes. For example, the American fencer Ibtihaj Muhammad, and there was no special celebration about the other Muhammad athlete that was a track and field athlete, Delilah, I think. And that just strikes me as kind of sad, you know, that we feel in this time of Trump's anti-Muslim bigotry, we have to then side with the minorities. A lot of people feel that, and I understand that, and I think it's a noble sentiment, but I don't think that the other option available should be we should praise every bad practice that comes from minority communities. And that's what ends up happening. I mean, I heard an interview with Ibtihaj, and she said that her mother chose fencing because she was driving by and she saw that this was a sport for fully covered people.
Oh my God.
And she didn't know what it was, but she's like, I gotta enroll my daughter immediately. And I'm like, this is a horrific reason to enroll your child in a sport, yeah, right? And yet she's being celebrated. So what are your thoughts on that? Hoda first and then Sarah?
Okay, so yeah, I think that for someone from the United States, living constantly, seeing the only time we see someone who wears the hijab on media is being berated, finally seeing someone who is wearing the hijab in a good light was refreshing, just because I've never seen that on mainstream Western media, never.
But does it have to be glorified? But
I think so. It's a form of representation. So, for example, like right now also, parallel to that conversation was a lot of conversations about how beautiful it is, like the black girl magic that was happening. There were so many black women doing amazing things, getting so many medals. And there was a huge like glorification of that too, because again, black women and black people in mainstream Western media usually are not shown in a nice light. So when they were finally portrayed in this beautiful, like heroic almost light that they got these medals, it's really nice. Like there's so many images of like young little black girls saying, wow, maybe I can do that too.
But and now for you're me, changing
especially
it.
When it comes to sports. No, it's very relevant because for me, something like when I was growing up, I played tennis. And I was really good, but because I wore the hijab, my coach told me, like to quote her words, she called me a disgrace to the team because I refused to wear a miniskirt. She called me a disgrace to the team because I didn't look like everybody
else. Well, that's horrible. That's horrible.
Exactly. Thank you. And I think so for me, I've always been, so that made me very uncomfortable to play sports. It made me always shy away from playing sports because my experiences with it was just very, very horrible. And so being able to see someone who wears the hijab, someone who looks like me, finally being portrayed in a good light, finally doing something that was pushed against, like society did not let me do. They called it repulsive. They said it was like they wouldn't let me be on the team. Like that, it was nice. I liked it. It was nice to see someone who wears the hijab, who looks like me, getting praised finally.
I just want to be
doing
clear
something that I was constantly being pushed out of.
I'm really sorry that you had to go through that. Like I truly am, and I wouldn't condone that kind of behavior at all. But my point is only to say that do we have to glorify this thing? Can't we just like have positive portrayals of hijabis that are just incidentally hijabis rather than celebrating the hijab itself?
I have a theory about
that. And I think that it's particular just because right now we are like, I would love for that to happen. Like I would love hijab to not be this little like exoticized thing. Like, oh my God, look, she's wearing the hijab, our hijabi athletes. No, mm-hmm. I want them to all be fabulous women. And some of them happen to wear hijab because they choose to, you know? But because right now we're at a time of heightened Islamophobia, which clearly this is very,
there we
very
go.
Can I just say the problem with the term Islamophobia? Happening? The problem with the term Islamophobia is that it conflates criticism of the religion with bigotry towards the people. And I don't think that that is really interchangeable like that. I am very critical of the religion, but I am very critical of people who are generalizing and bigoted towards Muslims as well. So can you see the difference? So don't you think...
No, I think there is a difference, but I think that's a whole other conversation about terminology. But like using that term right now to reflect anti-Muslim and hate crimes against
fundamental Muslims, not all Muslims.
So hate crimes against me, a non-fundamentalist. So that is how I'm defining it in this current point. So no, I do think that every term should be, as I come from a theoretical background, and I think terms should be acknowledged. And I mean, I'm just like thought about and dissected, but I'm talking about right now in a climate where a Muslim woman is tackled by CPD officers because they think she's ISIS, where a Muslim woman is kicked out of a store, where Muslims are kicked off of airlines for doing
that's
math.
That's Muslim phobia.
It's okay, Muslim phobia. If that's the word that you want to use to describe this, I'll use that for now. Of course, we can. I don't have time to get into a different debate.
Right.
I have to run.
Where are you going, Gil?
In this
where are you
time.
Going?
Where do why you is that to- relevant? How is that any of your business?
I want to know. Why don't you stay with us?
I have a life outside of discussing panels. I'm sorry. But yeah, so I think in this current time, if you want to use the word Muslimophobia, let's use that. In this current time, we have to be able to acknowledge and see that Muslims are also doing good things because we don't see that at all in media. So that's why I think that it should be acknowledged that these women are also wearing hijab.
Absolutely. But without celebrating the practice of hijab, can be done. It can be done.
Okay,
Sarah,
can I
jump over here?
Can we just give Sarah a chance to speak? And then you can talk, Hala, after Sarah.
Okay, well, you know, if we're about wrapping it up, I'm pretty sure this will be the last time I get to speak, but...
well, Sarah, you say that in such an ominous way.
No, I promise. I only have one point to make, and that's it. I'm going to be quiet.
Okay, well, I want to thank, you know, both Hala and Hoda for being here and for talking about their experiences. I found it, both of them, very interesting, and I found your back and forth to be very interesting, and I think we listeners will too. But as far as the hijabi athlete is concerned, I didn't like that at all. I didn't like the coverage at all. I thought and I understand what Hoda is saying, that it's nice to be represented in a positive light as, you know, someone representing her country, etc., and that is nice. However, I am disturbed by the tendency to look at Muslims, and especially Muslim women, as primarily being hijabi women.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like
that
to see...
That was my point. Thank you, Sarah.
You know, I would like to see women like Asr Nomani being represented as, you know, an example of a Muslim woman who, you know, thinks a certain way, maybe a little bit differently, but there seems to be a lot of politics that are involved in, you know, determining who is or isn't an, you know, quote unquote authentic voice for American Muslims and for Islam in general. And I'm disturbed by how visible, I mean, that may be just because the hijab is very conspicuous, but I think there's also a push to make the hijab a symbol for Muslims and Islam altogether, which I find disturbing. Yeah. And it creates this kind of very toxic atmosphere where other women, you know, feel like they can't speak and they're considered outsiders and black sheep and distasteful in some way, as you know, someone like the athlete would not. So
I think it's ignorance on part of the media more than it is a conscious choice, and so that's they associate Muslims and Islam in general with the hijabi or with the hijab itself. They're not aware that there are other Muslims, and this is only one part of Muslims. And this is a point that I try to emphasize anywhere, if I'm having an interview or if I'm writing. I always emphasize that this is just one group of Muslims, and not all Muslims have the same belief. Maybe they're more visible because they are conspicuous. So I think the concentration on the hijabi athlete was because they think, oh, we're celebrating Islam, we're celebrating all the Muslims.
Meanwhile, we had another Muslim athlete who was like in a crop top and shorts, and nobody really held her up as a symbol of being Muslim.
Right. Because I mean, she's not wearing the symbol, I think.
So there's many, I'm sure, you know, if it's hard to tell because there are, I don't think there's any, you know, surveys about this sort of thing, but I'm sure we've had many Muslim female athletes as part of, you know, Team USA in particular. And I think that, but they're, because, you know, that's not, they're not visibly Muslim. So any struggles that they have, may have faced to become an athlete are struggles that, that go unaddressed. So I wasn't encouraged to participate in sports. I was discouraged to participate because of the movement of my body, and it's, you know, it could be suggestive or whatever it is. So there is a difficulty, you know, if you are a liberal Muslim woman to participate. And I think that that just goes completely unaddressed because of just the visibility of the hijab.
Yeah, I think you're right. Hoda, any last comments before you go?
No, I mean, I feel like I've said a lot when I was able to speak and not be interrupted.
All right. I don't want you to go, so I'm going to be quiet. Come on, stay with us.
I really must go. But thank you so much for having me and helping me be part of this conversation.
Well, no, thank you. Thank you very much, because I understand if it was not in your comfort zone, but I really appreciate your openness and your willingness to want to discuss this. I think these are the conversations that will move us forward.
And I love you. I don't want you to go, and I love you. And I'm sorry if I gave you a hard time.
Aww, see, this is what polite conversations is all about.
I think you're adorable.
Say this, but you won't fight for my right to wear the hijab because you say it should be banned in public, so I don't know what to believe. Okay, on that note, that'll be my final note. Khalas. It was so nice speaking with all of you, and I wish you all the best.
Yeah, you okay, too. You Take too, care. Yeah, Take care, everyone. Thank you, Sarah, and Hala as well for taking
Thank
the time out to have this almost two-hour-long conversation. Wow. So yeah. Hopefully people will find it just as interesting as I did. I did find yours and Hala and Hoda, your exchanges and your butting heads to be fantastic. I loved it.
I loved Sarah so much too. She is such a very wise little girl. Young woman. A very wise young woman. And Hoda is adorable.
All right. Well, okay. Thank you. Thank you both. This was fun. I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Me too, very much.
All right, guys. Well, stay in touch, and maybe we can chat again. I know Sarah and I are in touch, but you, Hala, and Hoda.
Oh, I love this.
All right.
All right.
Take care, guys.
I love you.
Bye.
Bye. Take care.
Thanks for listening to another episode of Polite Conversations. You can support this podcast by sharing the shit out of it, making some noise about it, or contributing via Patreon. Patreon.com/nicemangoes. No E in mangoes. Also, you can follow me on Twitter @nicemangoes. If you want to make a one-time donation instead of a monthly Patreon one, you can do so via PayPal. nicemangoes.blog@gmail.com. Remember, no E in mangoes. If you've got an interesting story and would potentially like to be a guest, you can email me there too. A special thanks to Dylan Beck for theme music, sound, and production help.